Welcome back. This is Grandmaster Georg Meyer from Germany, and I will continue my series on the Catalan. And today we are going to look at a system that has become extremely popular at the highest level. And let's get right into it. So, after the usual introductory moves, we get to our starting position in the Catalan. And the line today is really black fighting over the center right from the start, because most of the time black is going dc4 and then leaves the center abandoned and hopes later to play c7 c5 in order to basically chip away at white's dominance in the center. And when black waits, this actually becomes quite difficult, because in the meantime white uses his extra space and central control to bring his pieces into better positions. And then sometimes it's just too late to try to fight back with c7, c5. So, in this line, after bishop g2, black does it immediately, doesn't wait any longer. And you might ask, why then to play dc4 and only then c5? c5 is possible at this point too, but basically, black is forced to make a concession after cd5, since you don't want to take back with the piece or with the queen, because either the queen is going to be harassed with knight c3, or the knight from d5 can be kicked with e4, which means that black would have to take back with the pawn, and this guy will eventually become isolated and weak. So this is a completely different opening called Tarrasch defense in the Queen's Gambit, and not the topic of our series. But dc4, bishop g2, c5, that's definitely an ambitious and healthy way to meet the Catalan, with the goal to just structurally equalize, taking away white's center, and then finish the development. And if black would also manage to finish his development, then he is fully equalized. So what I just said means also that white needs to use his normal initiative in chess that he has with, the first move. He has to act quickly and try to disturb black as long as development is not yet finished. And the most ambitious move is queen a4, and this is what we are looking at today. There are alternatives for white, for example, to play a quiet endgame here. Also not bad, but not the most testing. So, with queen a4, we use the fact that this diagonal is already exposed, and white may be threatening knight e5, completely overloading this knight on c6. And here there are already options for black. First of all, there is the move cd4, which used to be the main line in the old days. And let's have a quick look at this before we go to the modern main line, bishop d7. So, cd4. Here there's the nice trick of playing knight d4. Black has to take it. And now bishop c6. And of course, if bc6, queen c6 will pick up the rook. So black plays bishop d7. And now I invite you to find the point of white's idea. Maybe pause the video for a second and think what you do as white. So the whole point of this queen a4 line is to move rook d1. Now, well, first of all, I want to say that if white was just to take on d7, then black would achieve the goal of his opening line. He has successfully fought white's center, and he is about to finish development, and his rooks immediately get to the open files, and he has comfortable equality. So definitely it was necessary to have a move like rook d1 here. The point of the bishop c6, I hope you saw it, is queen takes c6. And after bc, rook d4, white recuperates the pawn on c4 and just has a very nice endgame advantage, because these two guys remain weak forever. So after, for instance, c5, rook c4, bishop e7, I think a good Plan of development for white is to play knight d2, knight b3, immediately ganging up on the c5 pawn. Black can be cunning because if the knight c5 there would be rook c8, just using the pin here. So we cannot cash in that fast, but we have the much better structure, so we also don't need to be in a rush. Bishop d2, also controlling a5 and just to prepare rook c1. And here white just enjoys a comfortable long-lasting advantage because black has no way to repair the structure. And if he would do something like this, trying to at least push his c-pawn, then knight a5 is just renewing the threats and eventually the pawn will fall. So after rook d1, there have been some people not playing bishop c6, but queen d1, and trying to hold this position after the queen sacrifice. But it turns out that white wins back the pawn, at least, and then has a free roller trying to win the game. Since here there's a neat tactic with knight c4, and it's not possible to take because queen a4 just wins the piece back immediately. So now we've covered the most straightforward reply to queen f4, which is cd4, and in modern times black refrains from cd4 in favor of playing bishop d7. Queen c4 is logical now, after all we need to take this pawn back. And here there are two moves. The most straightforward is cd4, knight d4, rook c8, logical, just continuing development on both sides. And finally, we get to this position. Black took on d4 so that he can develop with tempo. And here we get to a very interesting moment. It would be very desirable for black to play bishop c6, oppose the bishop on the long diagonal, and basically try to equalize. But the black king is still in the center and white manages to use this. First of all, with a tempo gaining move rook d1, taking on c6, and here there is a killer blow for white. Again, if you want to try to find it, pause the video for a second and think about the position. So the killer blow is bishop h6, just using the one moment that black is not yet fully mobilized, and castling is no option because there is even bishop g7, queen g5, and everything just falls with tempo. And of course bishop f8 is not a move anyone will ever want to make, and just saw a very nice line for white to finish off the game. Doubling on the d-file and then penetrating with both rooks, and this is already checkmate with the queen pinning the knight. So at this point bishop c6 is not really advisable and black has to sacrifice a pawn. And here there's a famous game between Vladimir Kramnik and Arkady Najdic, and it continued like this. Bishop on f3 covers e2 and g4, and sometimes the queen finds a way to come back like this, but here it is queen g5. And we should note that of course black is better mobilized, but there are no real weaknesses in white's camp. No, not even weak squares, because the white pawns are all very mobile still. And it is very hard for black to prove that he has enough compensation. In the game white went knight d1 and basically managed to drive the rook away from b4 so that there is not so much pressure anymore on b2. If black goes rook a4, then white can just get out with the pieces, knight a3, rook d1, queen c2, something like this. And well, it's a pawn up. So this line also doesn't work too well for black, and eventually the modern main line became not cd4 at this point, but b5. This move is kind of concession, because pawns don't move backwards, and in a moment we'll talk again about this concept. Queen c3, no need to play queen d3, inviting c4 with tempo. And here we just look at two moves to conclude this line. One is cd4, similar to the last line we looked at. So this is a game between Fabiano Caruana and again Arkady Najdic. And here we get to the decisive moment. Again, if black were to play rook d8, he would have equalized. But after knight e4, he is again a tempo short. So everyone is hanging. And if black takes on e4, there is a double attack against h7 and d7. So again, with natural moves, black has not managed. And therefore, the final attempt for black is to play not cd4, but b4 at this point. Queen d3, rook c8. Now white releases the tension on c5 by taking and develops the bishop. So, thus far very logical. And now let's try to understand why white played the last few moves as he did, taking on c5, exchanging on e3. In general, I would say if the black pawn was not on b4, but on b7 or b6, then in two moves or three moves, black would equalize, playing queen e7, rook d8, bishop e8, and everything is solid and fully developed. But as we said, the pawns don't move backwards, and squares on the c file have been exposed. c5, c4, the a pawn is a bit weak, and it is also not so easy for black to support this b4 pawn. In my opinion, the white knight should go to b3, covering not only the c5 square, but also a5 in case the a pawn would move forward. And then after putting a rook on the c file and going knight e5, eventually this g2 bishop would become very strong and white's pieces would start working together and just harmonizing very well on surrounding black's queen side. And eventually it will make itself felt that these two pawns are just exposed for the rest of the game. So there's been no instructive game from this moment on, but my general feeling is simply that white enjoys a long-lasting advantage because the black queen side is not intact anymore. So we've seen several lines that were characterized by quick development by black and where white had to use his first chance to strike and disturb black's plans, basically stopping him from finally equalizing, from finally completing the development. And the Catalan is an opening where white always has this last stingy move before black is there and ready to equalize. Hope you enjoyed this video and stay tuned for more.